All right, if I could have your attention, please. We want to welcome you to our youth conference for those that are here, especially tonight as we begin with the play, The Hiding Place. And let me explain a couple things. For those up in the auditorium, we are doing a live stream, so if you could kind of not get too into it too much, there'll be a lot of noise, so if you could just limit that. We will have about halfway through an intermission. What I'm going to ask you to do is not leave and go to the dorm or go to the Red Fox Cafe. Just stay here at about 15 minutes. If you need to use the restroom, obviously, go ahead and do that. But don't leave because I'm not going to round everybody up to get back into the building. So it's best if you just stay, fellowship a little bit, and then they'll restart. So hopefully, a lot of hours have been put in. Hopefully, you can just sit back and enjoy the program tonight called The Hiding Place.
Tell you about her. My name is Peter Van Warden, and Corey was my aunt. Now, I guess I should start at the beginning. She was born Cornelia Arnalda Johanna ten Boom in Amsterdam on April 15th, 1892. She was the third daughter and the fifth child of Casper and Cor ten Boom, and her father was a watchmaker in Harlem, Holland. He had a little shop on the street, and they all lived in the house above it. Now, our story begins in 1915. The occasion was the first sermon of Corey's brother Willem, my uncle. It was a special occasion which many had gathered for. But Corey was only concerned with one particular friend of Willem's, whom she was very glad had come.
Hey, Corey.
Carl, hello.
It's such a beautiful day today.
Yes.
So good to see you again.
And you.
Do you remember the last time at Willem's wedding?
Of course I do.
When I saw you, I couldn't believe how you'd grown into such a lovely lady. From the little girl with the enormous blue eyes, it's even truer today.
Thank you, Carl. So, tell me about your work.
Well, I love being an assistant pastor. It gives me great joy to serve the Lord in such a wonderful church.
I was so glad to hear that you would be coming to be at Willem's first sermon. I mean, it means so much to him, of course.
Oh, I wouldn't miss it. I'm so pleased he has his own pastorate. I was also looking forward to seeing you and your family again. Tell me about them. How are they?
Most of them are fine. Aunt Jans has left us. Her funeral was 4 months ago.
Oh, I did hear that she was kind of sick.
Yes. I was the one to check her blood for the sugar content. I did it every Friday. Tina taught me how to do it. As long as the mixture did not turn black, she was okay. You saw her at Willem and Tina's wedding. She was fine. But then one day, the mixture was black. I double-checked it just to make sure, and then I brought it to the doctors. He said it was right. So we all went in to tell her. Papa, of course, began. My dear sister-in-law, there is a journey which each of God's children sooner or later sets out on. And Jans, some must go to their father empty-handed, but you will run to him with hands full. And then, of course, we began to list all of her accomplishments, all of her writings, her clubs, her talks. But She just began to cry. She cried, empty. Empty. How can we bring anything to God? What does he care about our little tricks and trinkets? She lowered her hands, and with tears streaming down her face, she began to pray. Dear Jesus, I thank you that we must come to you with empty hands. I thank you that you have done all on the cross, and that all we need in life or death is to be sure of this.
Wow. To think that she could see that in such a time of sorrow.
It reminded me of something my father told me when I was just a child.
Well, tell me.
Well, I was crying because I had seen a baby who had died. When I saw how death could come at any time and take anyone, I was afraid. Afraid that death would come and take my mother or my father. I was crying, oh, Papa, you can't leave. I need you. He sat on the edge of my bed and softly spoke to me. He said, Corey, when you and I go to Amsterdam, when do I give you your ticket? I thought about it. Why, just before we get on the train. He said, exactly. And our wise Father in heaven knows exactly when we are going to need things too. We must not run ahead of God. When the time comes that sooner or later, some of us will have to die, you will look inside your heart and find the strength you need just in time.
Oh, Corey, I love your stories. You have a great family and such a wise father.
Oh, yes.
I could hear these stories all day long. My family has no such stories to tell.
Oh, I'm sure there's stories. You just have to think a little bit. You have to remember.
Well, we had some money and privileges. But sometimes I think I would give all of that up just to have a home like this one. To live in a house like this house you speak of. Not having so much, but having so very much. Do you understand what I mean?
I guess so.
Your brother Willem, he would tell me stories. He always spoke of you as such a little girl. I suppose you were then. I remember when we first met, when you and your sister came to see Willem's graduation.
No, it wasn't then. 2 years before, when I was only 14, you came to visit our house.
That's right. And remember, you were surprised that I had remembered?
I didn't think you had noticed me. I mean, why would a university student notice a teenage girl?
Well, you no longer seem like a little girl. You're a lady with those enormous blue eyes.
I think we already covered this topic.
Yes. Well, tell me about your sisters, Betsy and Ollie. How are they? Are they to be married? Do they have any interests?
Well, Nolly is just a couple years older than I am. She will marry. She always has lots of boyfriends. Betsy, I don't think Betsy will marry. She can't have children, so I think she's just decided never to marry.
And what about you?
I would like to marry. Lord willing, of course. I love children.
Yes. Yes, me too.
Carl stayed a few weeks. Even after Willem had given his first sermon and most of the family and friends had gone, he lingered on. He and Corey would meet to go for walks every day, and they talked about so many things. He told her how he wanted 4 children, and she told him how she wanted 6. But in all their talks, they never spoke of their love for each other or of marriage.
Do you see her? Is she out there?
No, not yet. But she will be. They meet to walk every day.
So you think this is best? That we just interfere like this and talk with her?
I don't want to see Corey get hurt. I think if we love her, we must tell her. Here she comes. Corey, good morning.
Willem, Tina.
Corey, has Carl...
Has Carl told you very, very much about his family?
Some. He says there's not much to tell.
I suppose he mentioned that his parents are well off. They seem to be high up in society.
Yes, a little.
Willem tells me that his mother is very particular about what she wants in life. And you know how mothers can be.
Yes, I do.
Has Carl led you to believe that he is...
Led you to believe that he's serious?
No, we... Why?
Because, Corey, this is something that can never be. You don't know Carl's family. They've wanted one thing since he was a small child. They've sacrificed for it, planned for it, built their whole lives around it. Carl is to marry you well, is the way I think they put it.
But what about what Carl wants? He's not a small child now.
He will do it, Corey. I don't say that he wants it. To him, it's just a fact of life like any other. When he and I talked about girls we liked at the university, he'd always say at the end, of course, I could never marry her. It would kill my mother.
He said nothing of his mother to me.
You're so abrupt. I think you could have done it more smoothly.
How can you be smooth about that? She would have taken it hard no matter what.
But she loves him.
I had hoped it would not have come to that.
She loved him from the first moment she ever saw him. I know she did. It's something I can tell. Betsy and Nolly have seen it too.
She reads too many books. They always have happy endings. But this is reality. I just don't want to see my little sister get hurt.
I was angry with Willem. He always saw the dark, hard side of things. I loved walking in the garden, where Carl and I had fallen in love. There was not a bush or a flower that he and I had not looked at together that didn't have a bit of our feeling still clinging to it. Sure, Willem may know more than me about theology, war, and politics, but when it came to romance, things like money, family expectations, social prestige, why in the books, they vanish like rain clouds every time. It was a week or so later when Carl finally had to leave.
Oh, Corey, here you are. I should have known I would find you here. It's time for me to go.
Yes, I know.
I realized that I said goodbye earlier, but I wanted to say it again. I'm so glad I got to come.
I'm sure Willem was very happy that you came, too. He gave a good message, didn't he?
Yes. The changing world and how nothing will ever be the same.
Quite a topic for his first sermon. I don't think the farmers and villagers really cared for it much. I was looking around at them during the sermon.
Well, do you think he was right?
Probably. Willem knows about these things. I enjoyed our walks and our talks.
Yes. Me too. Well, I guess this is goodbye.
goodbye, Carl.
Oh, Corey. I don't want to go. I don't want to. I have no choice. Will you at least write to me? Write to me about your home? About this old, crumbling, beautiful house? Write about how your father forgets to pay the bills? Corey, you have the most beautiful home in Holland. Will you please write to me?
I will, Carl.
Well, goodbye then.
Goodbye.
And her family returned to their happy home in Holland. It had always been a happy place, but now every little event seemed to glow because she could share it with Carl in her letters. Each meal she cooked was an offering to him. Every shining pot a poem, every sweep of the broom, an act of love. His letters did not come as often as hers went singing to him, but she put that down to his work. The minister he was assisting, he wrote, had turned the parish calling over to him. It was a wealthy congregation, and large contributors expected frequent and unhurried visits from the clergy. As time went by, his letters came more seldom, but she made up for it with hers. And after 5 months had passed, on a nippy November day, the doorbell rang. Expecting a neighbor, Corey went downstairs to answer the door, and there stood her beloved Carl, with his new wife. You can imagine Corey's shock and her heartbreak. She doesn't remember what she did or said or even taking them to the parlor room, but she must have. Everyone came to her rescue, talking, shaking hands, taking coats, finding chairs so that Corey would not have to say or do anything. Mama broke her own record for making coffee. Aunt Anna passed cakes. Betsy engaged a young woman in a discussion of all the latest winter fashions, and Father, he pinned Carl in a corner with questions of the most international and impersonal nature. What did he make of the news that President Wilson was sending American troops to France? Somehow, the half hour passed. Somehow, Corey managed to shake both of their hands and wish them every happiness. Betsy took them down to the door, and Corey headed up to her room.
Corey? Corey? Do you know what hurts so very much? It's love. Love is the strongest force in the world. And when it is blocked, that means pain. Now, there are two things we can do when this happens. We can kill the love so that it stops hurting. But then, of course, a part of us dies too. Or, Corey, we can ask God to open up a new route for that love to travel. God loves Carl, even more than you do. And if you ask him, he can give you his love for this man. A love nothing can prevent, nothing destroy. Whenever we cannot love in the old human way, Corey, God can give us the perfect way.
Oh, Lord, I give you the way I feel about Carl. my thoughts about our future. Oh, you know. Everything. Give me your way of seeing Carl instead. Help me to love him that way. That much.
It was a large house, and most of the family had grown, moved, or passed away. Only three live there now. Corey, her sister Elizabeth, who we called Betsy, and Father, who we grandchildren called Opa. Corey and Betsy had never married, so they ran the shop most of the time as Father Tin Boom was getting up in years. Corey even became the first woman to become a licensed watchmaker in Holland. They had a quiet life. Corey had a Bible class where she would teach handicapped children about God. The Ten Booms were a godly family, and Father Ten Boom was always willing to open his home to anyone in need and show them Christ's love. And this love for people, namely the Jewish people, led them into a life that changed our family forever. During World War II, the Nazis were persecuting Jews all over Europe, and it was no different in Holland. Germany had invaded Holland in 1940, and the terrible hate of the Jewish people by the new government was such an awful thing to behold. I even felt some of the changes firsthand when I was arrested for playing our national anthem on the church organ one Sunday. I played it at full volume, and everyone rose to their feet and sang. It was exhilarating. All of my family prayed for my release. Like I said, we were a godly family. And because of the obvious Christ-like compassion that the Ten Booms expressed, they were soon asked to hide Jews in their home.
Hi, I'm Betsy.
Oh, Kick, I didn't hear you come in.
Yeah, I was with Aunt Corey down at the shop. We went over a few things.
Kick, Corey tells me about the things that you do, and I worry. It sounds so dangerous. Riding bikes at night after curfew.
No one hears us. We wrap the wheel rims to keep down the rattle. And when we arrive at the secret house, we carry the bikes inside. There are no lights, so the streets are dark. No one sees us. It has to be that way in the underground.
Corey did not tell me everything. Are we really working for the underground? It sounds like we are.
Don't worry, Aunt Betsy. As you always say, God is with us always. Is there tea?
Oh, of course. Corey said that the people she met there are from the national group?
Yes, there were some very important people there. But mostly we just talked with Mr. Pickwick. He introduced us to Mr. Smith. But of course, they're all called Smith in the underground. I don't know most of their real names. You should have seen Aunt Corey last night. She was so nervous. Mr. Pickwick introduced her as the head of the operation in the city. She blushed to her hair roots.
Corey, head of an operation? She sounds like a criminal.
They have much to offer us. False identity papers, forged signatures, the use of a car with official government plate.
Be involved in this? How can we?
Aunt Betsy, it was that same night that we heard about Cousin Peter, that he was soon to be released, and he was released only 3 days later.
So you see, it is good.
Yes. That was an answer to our prayers. Oh, Kick, you must be careful.
Yes, well, I gotta go, Aunt Betsy. I'll talk to you later.
Father, did Betsy Corey tell you that we are having a visitor this morning?
Besides Kick? No, who's our guest?
It's a Mr. Smith.
Oh, has he come to have his watch repaired?
No, he's not a customer.
Where do we know him from?
Well, we don't know him. He's come to inspect the house.
Inspect the house? For what? Do we have bugs? I don't remember seeing any bugs.
No, Father, we don't have bugs. It's not that kind of inspection. Father, it's so that we can help people.
That is good. We must always be willing to open our home to anyone in need of help.
Yes, that's what we think. So we must have the house inspected so that we can hide the Jews.
Are we getting any new Jews? They come and they go, but they don't seem to stay very long. I like to talk with them. God has sent them here for a reason, and we must share Christ with them. I like to start with the Old Testament. It is a common ground.
Yes. Well, when the Gestapo comes, we need to be able to hide the Jews.
What's that?
Corey told you about that, didn't she?
What's that?
That we must hide the Jews. We have to build a place for them to hide.
We have a lot of rooms. Can they not hide there?
But we have to fool the Gestapo.
They're already fools. Anyone who says that you must hate someone just because they are Jewish is a fool. How could they tell anyways? I could say that I am a Jew. If we all said that we were Jews, they could not tell who was or who wasn't.
But that would not be the truth, Father.
Yes. We must always be truthful.
Yes. Well, that must be Mr. Smith. Now, when Corey brings him in, you must not ask too many questions.
Now, there are some that you can tell. They have that face, you know, that Jewish face. Sometimes you can tell by their names. They should change their names. The Smith, is he a Jew?
I don't know. I don't think so. But we don't know very much about him. That's the way they want it. Corey and I will show him around the house.
This is my sister, Betsy, and our father, Casper Tenboom. Papa, this is Mr. Smith.
Ah, Mr. Smith. I know several Smiths in Amsterdam. Are you by chance related to the family who...
Papa, this is the man I told you about. Remember, he's come to inspect the house.
Oh, a building inspector. Then you must be the Smith who works with the offices downtown. There's no wonder...
Papa, he's not a building inspector, and his name is not Smith.
Not Smith?
For my own protection, and also for yours, I do not use my real name. Schmidt is a common name used in the underground.
Yes, he's really here to see about building a place to hide the Jews. I met him through Pickwick.
I simply cannot understand a man who's chosen to be called a name not his own.
Let me help you out, Father.
Smith. I used to know a Smith on Koningsstraat.
We hide the ration cards underneath the bottom step.
Good. And how do you warn the people?
Well, you may have noticed when you walked in the shop, there's a warning sign in the window. It's a sign for Alpina watches. As long as that sign for Alpina watches is in that window, it's safe to enter.
Good, very good.
Whoever built the house left a small space behind the cupboard. That's where we hide the silver, gold, and other valuable items.
We thought of that together.
First place they'd look. Oh. Don't bother to change it, though. It's only silver. We're interested in saving people, not things.
Oh, you're right. This way, Mr. Smith.
Miss Tenboom, I must say, this house is constructed wonderfully well.
Why, thank you. The only place left to see is my room at the very top of the house. I'm sure you probably...
Well, let's see it.
Oh, okay.
What an impossibility. What an improbable, unbelievable, unpredictable impossibility. Miss Tenboom, if all houses were constructed like this one, you would see before you a less worried man. This is it. You want your hiding place as high as possible. It gives you the best chance of reaching it while the search is going on below.
Mr. Smith, this is my bedroom.
Yes.
Okay.
This is where the false wall will go. And this is as big as I dare. Will it fit a cot mattress, though? Yes, easily.
My bedroom.
We will be delivering bricks to the house. They will come few at a time in briefcases.
Bricks? You're going to use bricks? Wouldn't wood be easier to build with?
Wood? Wood sounds hollow. No. Bricks are the only thing for false walls. It'll be done in roughly a week. First the bricks, then the plaster, then the carpenter, then the painter. It'll look just as it does now. You won't be able to tell the difference. Just the room will be smaller. We'll put a sliding panel in the wall about 2 feet high and 2 wide, and a vent in the real wall allowing air from the inside, or from the outside. Keep a water jug in there and change the water once a week, and keep all your guest possessions in the room, except the clothes actually on their backs. The Gestapo could search for a year. They will never find this one.
So tell me, Mr. Ten Boom, how long have you been hiding the Jews?
I don't know. Betsy, how long has it been?
A couple years now. They come and they go.
So you've had the hiding place this whole time?
It was built in 42, so almost 2 years now.
I must say, all the drills, running up the stairs to a hole in the wall, is it all really necessary?
Mr. Mosul, if it happens for real, you will be grateful that we rehearsed it so many times.
Ms. Ten Boom, you know that my name is Meyer Mosul, and you have been good to address me by my name. However, I happen to know in private that you and your sister have chosen to call me by the name of Yussi, making light of my academic achievements. If that is the name you have chosen for me, then please have some courtesy and say it to my face.
Mary, have some tea. I'm sure it will help with your asthma, I think.
Betsy, how's your sister? I felt so bad we had to go in her room while she lay there so sick.
Yes, she has the fever, sore throat, and a headache. I do hope she can rest. You know how Corey is. She's just been working herself too much.
Mm. Mr. Tenbo, I'd like to thank you for inviting us into your home. I don't understand why you do it.
It is what our Lord would have us to do. We want to show Jesus' love.
But everyone hates Jews.
Hating someone just because they're of a different race or religion, it is not God's way.
But what of the Christians who say it was the Jews who killed your Jesus?
That is not a Christian talking, if you ask me. Christ died for our sins. We all killed him, Jews and Gentiles alike. What is happening in the world today is evil, and it is wrong. We believe that we show true Christian love in this way.
Yes, I think so too. At least there are several grateful Jews in this household who would agree.
And thank the Lord we don't have any babies right now. It is so dangerous for them.
You've had babies here?
Yes, but they can't stay long.
Let me tell you a story. About a year ago, a tiny baby and her mother were brought here from the hospital. We took them in. The next day, a clergyman, a friend from the country, came by to have his watch repaired. Corey took the watch and promised to have it fixed. And then she said she had something to confess. Confess, he said, and she continued, I confess I need something from you. Would you be willing to take a Jewish mother and her child into your home? They will almost certainly be arrested otherwise. The man turned pale. Miss Ten Boom, I hope you are not involved in this undercover business. It's not safe. Think of your father and your sister. So Corey went into the other room and brought out the baby, hoping that the man would see the child and his heart would not resist. I entered the room. The man was saying, no, definitely not. We could lose our lives for this Jewish child. So I told Corey to bring the child to me, and she put him in my arms. And then I looked at the pastor and said, "You think we could lose our lives for this Jewish child? I consider that the greatest honor that could come to me and my family."
Well, what did he say?
Nothing. He just walked out of the room.
But what about the baby?
They were taken to a barn in the country, but when the Gestapo raided the farm, the mother became hysterical. We never learned what happened to them. That must be a customer. With Corey being sick, I closed the shop.
Opa, can you recite the 166th psalm?
The 166th psalm? There is no...
Shall I recite it for you? Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye...
But may. That is Psalms 100. Oh, yes. Psalms 100 and Psalm 66. They both start the same way. Psalms 100 and 60s.
Hey, Lord, heard what it's read.
It could be a drill.
Not with Corey sick in bed.
Today. Where's Mary? Mary? Mary! Hurry, please. Lord Jesus, you have the power to heal. Heal Mary now.
What is your name?
What?
Your name!
Cornelia Tenboom.
We've got one more up here. Get up! Get dressed! So you're the ringleader. Tell me now, where you hide the Jews?
I don't know what you're talking about.
And you don't know anything about an underground ring either?
No.
We will see about that. Let me see your papers. Hurry up! Here's the other one listed at the address. My information says she's the ringleader of the whole outfit. You know what to do. Hallelujah!
Now then, Fräulein, I am known as a very compassionate man if I am given the right answers. You answer my questions correctly, I will not hurt you. So, where are the Jews?
We don't have any Jews.
Wrong. Where did you hide the ration cards?
I don't know what you're talking
about. Wrong again! I will give you one more chance. If you do not answer correctly, I will hurt you. Where is the secret room?
There is no secret
room. Where is the secret room? Where are you hiding the jewel? Where did you hide the ration card?
Please, Lord Jesus, protect me.
If you say that name one more time, I will kill you.
Please, please.
If you won't talk, the other one will. Now move! Schnell!
Are you all right?
I'm fine.
Steal it! Your sister is here!
Betsy, they hurt you.
Yes. My heart is pained for him, for all of them. The Germans, in persecuting the Jews, they are touching the apple of God's eye, and they will be judged.
Prisoners, Bill remains silent. Law-abiding citizens, are we? Radios are forbidden! Old man, I see you believe the Bible. What does your Bible say about obeying the government?
It says, fear God and honor the Queen.
The Bible does not say that! Your Bible does not say that!
No, it says, fear God and honor the King. But in our case, that's the Queen.
It is not the King or the Queen. We are the legal government now, and you are all lawbreakers. An illegal radio and a telephone. Answer.
This is the Tempum residence and shop. This is the Tempum residence and shop.
Berman's been taken to the police station. That means they're on to everything. Miss Tempum?
Answer!
This is the Tempum residence and shop.
Hello! Hello! Our friends have wised up. But I have heard enough. Who is at the door?
There was an old man at the door. He said he was a retired missionary. Also, there was a group of people across the hall having a secret meeting.
Who were they?
My sister, my brother, my nephew.
What kind of a meeting was it?
It was just a prayer meeting.
That is what they said. They said that most of them had gone. We hold the rest over there. And we have searched the entire house. If there is a secret room, the devil himself built it.
Well, I do believe that there is a secret room here, and Jews are hiding in it, or else they would have admitted it. So I'm going to set a guard around the house until each and every one of them have turned to mummies. Now get your coats, get your hats, and we are going to move. Old man, there's no reason for you to go to prison. If you behave, I'm sure they will let you go. And for all I care, you can rot in your bed like an old man should.
If I am here, I'll open my door again to any man who needs help.
Very well. You have made your choice. Now move!
Thank you.
Corey spent the next 6 months locked up in a dark prison cell. She managed to get a Bible, which brought her much comfort, especially after learning that her father had died in a hallway in a hospital. When they had the reading of Opa's will, she was temporarily reunited with her family. Most of us had been released by then. My parents were there, and Uncle Willem and Aunt Tina. Aunt Corey and Aunt Betsy had to go right back to their cells, but they learned the good news that the Jews hiding in the secret room were safe. They had escaped. One day in August, the prisoners were all taken out of their cells and loaded onto trains to be taken to a work camp in southern Holland. And it was then that Corey was reunited with her sister Betsy, and they were able to remain together. Just a few weeks after that, they were packed again like cattle into trains to be taken into Germany. Now, if you can, imagine thousands of women being ushered into this awful place, not knowing the torture and possible death that awaited them.
Corey, I don't think I can bear this. Look, they're making them take off all of their clothes. The shame of it. We will lose everything.
Betsy, your sweater. You need that. And the vitamins. Get those out. We need those. And, oh, most importantly, we need that Bible.
Yes.
Oh, Lord Jesus, you've given us your precious book. You've kept it safe through checkpoints and inspections. You've used it for so many. Excuse me, sir. Could you direct us to the toilets?
Showers! Use the drain holes.
Corey, you are so bold. Sometimes it frightens me.
Betsy, I am just as frightened as you are. Oh, that man was so awful. Dirty Nazi.
Corey, you must not say things like that. It's not Christ-like. We have to keep our heads about us.
But look at this place. It's so, so, oh, and the smell. Use the drain holes, indeed.
What are these garments piled all over the floor?
This must be what they expect us to wear. Not much to it.
No.
Betsy, the door is closed. We are alone. That bench in the corner.
Oh. It's covered in mildew and cockroaches.
Yes, it's perfect. Betsy, quickly, take off your sweater. I'm gonna wrap up the Bible and vitamins and put them in this bench among the mildew and cockroaches. Sure, it may be disgusting, but perhaps no one will notice. After we shower, we'll just come back and get them. Elizabeth Tenboom. I fail to see the humor in this situation.
Well, you should just see yourself. What? You look, well.
Oh, that must have been my hair I was smelling.
Perhaps. Well, I guess I don't look much better.
No.
Corey, do you really think it will work?
I can't think of anything else.
Corey, you prayed. You prayed. This is from the Lord. Do you remember what Father was reading from the scriptures the night that we were all arrested? Thou art my hiding place and my shield. I hope in thy word. Hold thou me up, and I shall be safe. Corey, I am so thankful that we are here together.
Me too.
This is going to be so humiliating. Those SS men are just walking about. We have no privacy. It is so awful.
I know, but those showers are going to feel good. That cold water on our lice-eaten skin. I'll be thankful for the showers.
Yes. Praise the Lord for the showers.
When the shower was over, my aunts found some dresses to put on, and Corey gathered up their hidden bundle. She tied the sweater back around her waist, and she put the Bible between her shoulders again. She found a dress for Betsy that was big enough, with long sleeves, that it would hide the sweater, so that she could wear it later underneath the dress. And Betsy commented that nothing was hidden very well. The sweater was bulging from beneath Corey's thin cotton garment, and the Bible was so lumpy that it could be spotted from clear across the marketplace where they used to shop back home in Holland. Corey somehow felt that since there was no real way to conceal anything, that perhaps it didn't really matter. She had the incredible feeling that this was not her business, but God's. That all she had to do was to walk straight ahead.
Everyone, there's no way that they will not see it. You will be shot.
I prayed, Betsy. It's up to the Lord now.
Keep the line moving and no talking. All prisoners must be searched and all personal belongings must be left behind. Show me.
What is this?
That's mine, you can have it!
Throw it away and search her again.
No!
Throw it away and search her again!
You will stand still! Oh, I bet you are hiding something good.
Corey, we made it.
It's not over yet.
Keeps the line moving!
It'd be so nice to get into a warm bed and get a good night's sleep.
A good night's sleep. A good night's sleep! Roll call at Ravensbrück. It's 4:30 a.m. Everyone will report to roll call. There'll be no exceptions. This is a work camp. You are not here to rest. You are here to work. Now get out of my way!
I hear they call her the snake.
You will find your bunks immediately. You will be up at dawn. Working harder than you've ever worked in your insignificant little lives. Now move! Schnell!
Corey, are you all right?
Yes. The Lord has brought his word into the very pit of hell.
Yes.
You two! Why do you still stand here? You need to listen when orders are given at Ravensbrück. If you don't, there will be consequences to pay. Now tell me, why are you here?
What?
Why are you here?
We don't know.
You were arrested, yes? Political?
I guess it was political. We showed kindness and love to Jewish people.
Fools! Clearly against the law. But we will show you what happens to lawbreakers. We will show you who is in charge. You will work. You will work hard or we will make you work. Now get out of my sight!
In the weeks and months to come, Corey and Betsy worked very hard at the camp, and they so appreciated every moment that they could be together. Betsy became weaker and weaker and could hardly do the work, and Corey found it much harder than Betsy to maintain a good attitude about the place where God had them. In the bunkhouse at night, Betsy would gather a few women around for some time of reading the Bible and prayer. But Corey was struggling with why God would have them endure such hardship. And she was so concerned for her sister's well-being. As they approached Christmas, the weather had turned very cold, and the snow was everywhere, and Betsy, she was only getting worse. One morning, when it came time for roll call, she could not even move her legs. This was going to be a difficult morning, as sometimes they stood for hours out in the cold at roll call.
I don't understand why I cannot stand up or walk. My legs are so weak. I don't think I will make it through roll call.
It's okay, Betsy. We'll be able to hold you.
But sometimes they make us stand there for hours. What if they see us, and what if you weaken?
There will be some 35,000 women standing out there. They may not even notice.
Don't worry, Betsy. We'll take care of you, after all you've done for us.
It has all been the Lord, and you're right. I must not worry. I must be thankful for all things, even my legs, when they don't work. Corey, we have so much to be thankful for.
Yes, I guess we do.
Do you remember 1 Thessalonians? In everything, give thanks. Corey, I'm thankful that we are here together.
Me too, Betsy.
And I'm thankful for the barracks, that we've had no inspections here. And I'm thankful for God's word being here with us.
And for how he got his word into Ravensbrück. That was a miracle.
Yes. And the Bible studies and the readings. In the barracks, so many women have heard God's word read. We've had so many answers to prayer. Corey, we can be thankful for the crowding. We are all packed so close that when we read the word of God, all the women can hear. Corey, thank him.
Oh, thank you, God. For the jammed, crammed, stuffed, packed, suffocating crowds.
And thank him for the fleas.
Betsy, you always thank him for the fleas, and I just don't understand why.
I can think of one reason.
And what is that?
Well, the guards will hardly step a foot in the barracks because of all the fleas.
Well, I guess I can be thankful for the fleas now. It's going to be hard to be thankful to spend Christmas in this place.
Oh, Corey, we can be thankful. The Lord has shown me that we will be out of prison.
Roll call!
All prisoners will stand by themselves.
It's my sister. She's too weak.
Then she reports to sick call.
But she's too sick to stand.
I said she reports to sick call.
She does not look well.
I am fine.
Take her back to the barracks.
But I thought you said...
I said take her back before I change my mind.
Bring a stretcher to Barrack 28. Take this prisoner to the hospital. She does not need to wait in line. Her sister can go with her.
It was very strange that the woman whom they referred to as the snake would do something so incredibly nice. Going in on a stretcher meant that Betsy could skip past the long line of people waiting at the hospital. And allowing Corey to go with her, that was just completely unheard of. It seemed that there was a touch of compassion in the mean woman after all. Corey wasn't sure how long she could stay by Betsy's side, but she stayed as long as she felt she could.
See, the Lord is good. I am able to be here with you. The guards didn't stop me when I came in. They'll take good care of you here. You need rest and care. I think the Lord is even touching the snake's heart.
Even the snake. Corey, he loves her too. And he wants her to be his child.
Be still and rest now. Don't talk.
Corey, we must tell people what we have learned here. We must tell them that there is no pit so deep that he is not deeper still. They will listen, Corey, because we have been here.
But when will all of this happen, Betsy?
Oh, very soon. The Lord has shown me that by the first of the year, we will both be free.
I must explain to you all of the things I felt in the days to come. I tried to come and visit my sister, but it was only through the window. She would smile at me, and we would read each other's lips. Then one day, as I looked in the window, I saw the nurses come and wrap up a body in a sheet, carry it out. Betsy! But she had too much to do. She could not. I turned from the window and ran along the side of the building, chest hurting me as I breathed. Then I remembered the washroom window. My feet carried me mechanically around to the back of the building, and there, with my hand on the windowsill, I stopped. Suppose she was in there. Suppose they had laid Betsy on that floor. I started walking. I walked for a long time with that same pain in my chest, each time my feet carrying me back to the same washroom window. I would not go in. I would not look. Betsy could not be in there.
Thank you.
Please, please come with me.
I know, Mean. I already know. Please, 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 I don't want to
please,
see.
Please, Corey.
No, please. Okay. I know. Scott, please. Okay. I don't want to see, please.
It's okay.
No.
Corey. Look. Look at him, Corey.
Betsy. Oh, Lord. What have you done? Lord. What are you saying? What are you giving me? There lay Betsy, her eyes closed as if in sleep, her face full and young. The care lines, the grief lines, the deep hollows of hunger were simply gone. In front of me was the Betsy of Harlem, happy and at peace, stronger, freer. This was the Betsy of heaven, bursting with joy and health. Even her hair was graciously in place, as if an angel had ministered to her.
In tears, Corey ran back to the bunkhouse. This was not what Betsy was talking about, was it? Betsy had said she felt the Lord telling her that they would be out before the new year. And now Betsy was out of her pain and out of this wretched place. The other prisoners quickly turned to Corey for their spiritual leadership, and she had to pick up right where Betsy had left off, comforting the others as she was going through her own grief. Christmas passed, and one cold morning in late December, Corey was released. At first, she was just told to stand off to the side during roll call, and she didn't know why. A young woman named Tiny was put next to her, and they stood there for 3 hours talking. Tiny was certain that they were being sentenced to death, and so while they stood there, Corey witnessed to her and led her to the Lord, all the while wondering if she would soon be meeting her Savior in glory herself. Later that day, Corey was taken to the hospital and treated for her swollen feet, and just a few short days later, she was recovered and walking out of Ravensbrück with release papers in hand. On her way to the gate, someone stopped her and told her that Tiny had passed away that morning, along with another woman that had come to know Christ during their times of Bible study. And Corey thought how it was worth it to endure it all, if just for those two women to come to know Christ. On New Year's Day, Corey was on a train en route to her home in Holland. She and Betsy had always talked of setting up houses of ministry to help the needy, the handicapped, and those who were like them, coming out of concentration camps. And everything that Betsy had said would happen did. But Betsy was not there to see it. We had lost Aunt Betsy and Opa, and my cousin Kick, who died in a concentration camp in Bergen-Belsen. Eventually, Corey was encouraged to go and share her story of her whole ordeal. And she began to speak at various places. The Lord seemed to be opening doors all over for her to go and tell the story of how God's love carried her through. And one night, just a few years after the war ended, she was speaking in a church in Germany.
When we confess our sins, God casts them into the deepest ocean, gone forever. And although I cannot find a scripture for it, I believe God then places a sign out there that says, "No fishing allowed." Thank you, and God bless you.
There were never questions after a talk in Germany in 1947. People stood up in silence, collected their wraps, and left the room. And that's when she saw him, working his way to the front of the room towards her. One moment she saw the black coat and his hat, but the next, she saw the uniform and the visor cap with its skull and crossbones. And it all came back with a rush. The huge room, the pile of dresses and shoes on the floor. The shame of walking naked past that man. The place was Ravensbrück, and the man working his way to the front of the room towards her had been a guard, one of the cruelest guards. And there she stood. She, who had spoken so glibly of forgiveness, fumbling in her pocketbook, rather than take that man's outstretched hand. He would not remember her, of course. How could he? Remember one woman among those thousands of prisoners, but she remembered him. She was face to face with one of her captors, and her blood seemed to freeze.
Fräulein, that was a very good testimony. You mentioned Ravensbrück in your talk. I was a guard there, but since that time, I have become a Christian. And I know God has forgiven me for the horrible and cruel things that I did, but I would like to hear it from your lips as well. Fräulein, could you forgive me?
And I stood there. I, whose sins had again and again to be forgiven, and could not forgive. Betsy had died in that place. Could he erase her slow and terrible death simply for the asking? It must have been seconds, but seemed hours that he stood there. As I wrestled with the most difficult thing I ever had to do. For I had to do it. I knew that. Jesus says, "If you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will he forgive yours." I knew that as a commandment of God and as a daily experience. I had been working with victims of Nazi brutality, those who could forgive. Could return to the outside world and rebuild their lives. Those who nursed their bitterness remained invalids. It was as simple and horrible as that. And still I stood there with that coldness clutching my heart. But forgiveness is not an emotion.
Forgiveness is an act of the will, regardless of the heart's temperature. Oh, Lord Jesus, help me. I can lift up my hand. I can do that much. You supply the feeling. And so, woodenly, mechanically, I placed my hand into the one stretched out before me. And as I did, an incredible thing took place. The current started in my shoulder, raced down my arm, and sprang into our joined hands. Then this healing warmth seemed to spread throughout my entire being, bringing tears to my eyes. I forgive you, brother, with all of my heart. It was a long moment. The former guard and the former prisoner. I had never felt God's love as intensely as I did in that moment, for it was not my love. I had tried and did not have the power. It was the power of the Holy Spirit working in me, the love of God shed abroad in my heart. And I knew then that no pit is so deep, that He is not deeper still.